Hello and welcome to BYJU'S IAS. Let's take up the analysis of today's The Hindu newspaper. As part of the International Tiger Day, which is celebrated on the 29th of July, Prime Minister Narendra Modi has released the Status of Tigers in India 2018 report. This report contains the results of the All India Tiger Estimation or the Tiger Census, which was carried out in 2018. According to the results of this census, India has registered a tiger count of 2,976, and this is a phenomenal jump as compared to previous assessments. In 2010, 13 countries which are part of the tiger range, they came together and they adopted the St. Petersburg's Declaration. Under this declaration, the 13 countries committed to protect the tiger, which is declared as an endangered species by the IUCN. The main objective of the St. Petersburg's Declaration was to prevent the extinction of the tiger population in the wild. And through this declaration, the 13 countries adopted a global target to double the tiger population in the wild by the year 2022. So as far as India is concerned, if you compare the tiger estimates of 2010 with that of 2018, we can clearly say that India has almost achieved the target which was laid out under the St. Petersburg's Declaration. And also remember that it was through this declaration that 29th of July was designated as the International Tiger Day. Now, before we look at the results of the census, let us talk about tiger conservation in India. See, India has always been one of the major habitats for tigers in the wild. And even today, India alone accounts for nearly 75% of the tiger population. So since India was a major habitat, and since the tiger was its national animal, India launched an exclusive program to conserve the tiger population in the wild. This program is popularly referred to as Project Tiger, and it was initiated in 1973. Under Project Tiger, a number of tiger reserves were established in the country in order to protect the habitat of the tigers and provide for the conservation of this endangered species. But between 1973 and 2006, Project Tiger was largely a failure because of the lack of focus on biodiversity and environment conservation in India. In 2005-2006, there were alarming reports coming out by environment activists and conservation groups that the tiger population in India was declining at a rapid rate. So in the backdrop of these alarming reports, the then Prime Minister Manmohan Singh constituted a tiger task force in order to suggest recommendations to reform India's Project Tiger. The tiger task force recommended the creation of a National Tiger Conservation Authority for implementing Project Tiger. Based on this recommendation, the Prime Minister constituted the NTCA in 2005, and this body was given the statutory status by amending the Wildlife Protection Act in 2006. So with a renewed focus and a new sense of urgency, India started focusing on the conservation of tigers. And as a part of these efforts, the first All India Tiger Estimation was carried out in 2006. This was carried out by the National Tiger Conservation Authority in coordination with the Wildlife Institute of India, which is an autonomous body that is funded by the Ministry of Environment and Forest. So these two organizations came together to carry out the first ever All India Tiger exercise, and since then, it has become an exercise which is carried out once in every 4 years. According to the 2006 census, India hardly had around 1,411 tigers. This increased marginally to 1,706 in the 2010 census. For the 2014 census, the estimation methodology was completely upgraded, and India recorded a significant increase in the tiger population of around 2,226 tigers. And according to the latest census report of 2018, India has registered around 2,976 tigers. Now let us look at some of the key findings of the 2018 census report. Madhya Pradesh has overtaken Karnataka and it has registered the highest number of tigers in the country. According to the census report, Madhya Pradesh has reported around 526 tigers, whereas Karnataka closely follows behind Madhya Pradesh with a tiger count of 524. In the previous census, that is in the 2014 report, it was Karnataka which had the highest number of tigers in the country. But right now, Madhya Pradesh has overtaken Karnataka by a very narrow margin. Then at the third position, we have Uttarakhand with a tiger population of 442. So these are the top three states as per the 2018 census report. And if you look at Chhattisgarh and Mizoram, these are the only two states in the country which have registered a decline in the tiger population. Next, if you look at individual tiger reserves, the Pench Tiger Reserve in Madhya Pradesh has registered the highest count of tigers. And the Satyamangalam Tiger Reserve in Tamil Nadu has registered the maximum improvement since 2014. Next, on page number 9, we have two more articles related to the tiger census. According to the census report, the Pench Tiger Reserve in Madhya Pradesh and the Periyar Tiger Reserve in Kerala have been ranked as the best managed tiger reserves in India out of the total 50 tiger reserves. And due to their poor performance, the Rajaji Tiger Reserve in Uttarakhand and the Dampa Tiger Reserve in Mizoram have been placed at the bottom of the list. Based on their low scores, the Rajaji Tiger Reserve has been ranked at the 49th position, whereas the Dampa Tiger Reserve has been ranked at the 50th position. And the census report has also categorized the tiger reserves into 5 different geographic clusters. So this includes the Shivalik Hills and Gangetic Plains, Central India and Eastern Ghats, Western Ghats, Northeast Hills and Brahmaputra, and the Sundarbans. So the 50 tiger reserves of India have been classified under 5 different geographic clusters for the sake of comparison. So amongst these 5 clusters, Central India and Eastern Ghats have performed the best as compared to its performance in the previous census. According to the 2018 census, the highest tiger count is found in the Central India and Eastern Ghats geographic cluster. This is closely followed by the Western Ghats with a total tiger count of 981. So for the sake of prelims, kindly remember as to how the tiger reserves have been classified into 5 different geographic clusters, and also remember the performance of the top 2 clusters. And during the 2018 census, the Ministry of Environment and Forest had asked the Wildlife Institute of India to estimate the economic value of the tiger reserves as well. Since tiger reserves are a part of protected areas, they add significant value in the form of carbon sequestration, timber, ecotourism, and they also support the livelihood of the forest-dwelling communities. So by looking at these economic contributions of tiger reserves, the Wildlife Institute of India has estimated that the 50 tiger reserves contribute to around 4,200 crore to 16,000 crore rupees annually to the Indian economy. Now let us quickly talk about Project Tiger and the National Tiger Conservation Authority. As we discussed earlier, Project Tiger was launched in 1973 to conserve the tiger population. It is a centrally sponsored scheme of the Ministry of Environment and Forest. Through this project, the Ministry of Environment is providing central financial assistance to tiger states which are involved in tiger conservation through the management of tiger reserves. Initially, the project started out with around 9 tiger reserves, but today the number has increased to 50 tiger reserves. And these protected areas are present in 18 tiger range states. And in the management of tiger reserves, the core buffer model is employed by the National Tiger Conservation Authority. This is a strategy which was recommended by UNESCO for the conservation of biosphere reserves. So the similar approach has been adopted for conservation of tiger reserves as well by the National Tiger Conservation Authority. Under the core buffer model, the tiger reserve is divided into the core area and the buffer zone. The core area is given the same legal status as that of a national park or a wildlife sanctuary, and all human activities are completely prohibited in the core area. In the core zone, the exclusive focus is on the conservation of tiger. So as a result, all human activities are prohibited, including cattle grazing, collection of minor forest produce, recreation, etc. Whereas the buffer zone consists of a mix of forest and non-forest land, and the focus in this region is to provide for an inclusive people-oriented agenda. In the buffer zone, the main focus is to ensure the well-being of the village communities which are present around the core area. This will not only help in the conservation of the tiger population, but it will also help in reducing the chances of man-animal conflict. So in the buffer zone, minimal human activities are allowed in order to sustain the livelihood of village communities that are present around the core area. But these human activities are tightly regulated by the authorities so as to ensure that they do not have an impact on the tiger population present in the core areas. Next, if you look at the National Tiger Conservation Authority, it was established in 2005 based on the recommendations of the Tiger Task Force, which was set up by Prime Minister Manmohan Singh. This conservation authority was also given the statutory status by amending the Wildlife Protection Act of 1972 in 2006. So today, the NTCA is solely responsible for implementing Project Tiger, and it also has the overall responsibility for managing all the tiger reserves in India. As a part of this responsibility, the NTCA has to come up with a customized conservation plan for each and every tiger reserve. So the NTCA falls under the Ministry of Environment and Forest, and it plays a very crucial role in coordinating with the state governments as well. It tries to bridge the gap between the center and the state by working out a customized plan for the conservation of each tiger reserve. And the Union Minister for Environment and Forest acts as the chairman of the National Tiger Conservation Authority. Next, we have an article on page number 1, which refers to a canine which has successfully prevented poaching and illegal trade of wildlife products in the Kaziranga National Park. The details of this article is not relevant to us, but it mentions an international organization known as TRAFIC. TRAFIC stands for the Trade Record Analysis of Flora and Fauna in Commerce. It is basically an international NGO that was established in 1976 with the joint partnership of the WWF, or the World Wildlife Fund. Now it is known as the Worldwide Fund for Nature and the IUCN. So these two conservation groups came together to set up TRAFIC as an NGO in 1976, and it is headquartered at Cambridge in United Kingdom. Its main responsibility is to monitor the trade in wildlife products. So by monitoring the global movement of wildlife products, TRAFIC plays a very important role in preventing hunting, poaching, and wildlife trafficking. So the organization plays a very important role in biodiversity conservation and sustainable development, and hence it can be very important for prelims. And also remember that TRAFIC has established very close connections with other conservation groups such as IUCN, the United Nations Environment Programme, the CITES Convention, etc. Now let's take up the next article. The Center for Science and Environment has carried out an evaluation of the environmental impact of the fertilizer industry in India as a part of its Green Rating Project. The Green Rating Project, was started by the Center for Science and Environment in 1997 as an independent evaluation project. This is considered as one of the most rigorous exercises in evaluating the environmental impact of various industries in India. So this time, the Center for Science and Environment has evaluated the environmental performance of the fertilizer industry. According to this report, the fertilizer industry in India has shown a major improvement in energy efficiency and in reducing greenhouse gas emissions. The report says that by adopting the latest technology in the manner of production, the fertilizer industry has become energy efficient and it has managed to bring down the emissions of greenhouse gases. So on these two accounts, the Indian fertilizer industry is amongst the best performing in the world. As compared to other countries, the Indian fertilizer industries, they are more energy efficient and they emit very less greenhouse gases. But on the other hand, the fertilizer industry is highly water intensive. The industry consumes large quantities of water in the production of fertilizers. So on this account, the performance of the Indian fertilizer industry is not appreciable, because they are found to be lacking when it comes to reducing water consumption, and the industry is also contributing significantly to water pollution. And the article also talks about the environmental damage caused by the fertilizer industry, and this can be very important for prelims. The fertilizer industry, especially the nitrogen-based industries, they can contribute to the disruption of the natural nitrogen cycle. The nitrogen cycle is one of the biogeochemical cycles, and this can be disrupted by the emissions of the fertilizer industry. The industry also significantly contributes to climate change through the emission of greenhouse gases such as nitrous oxide, methane, carbon dioxide, etc. All the three greenhouse gases have a very high global warming potential, and they contribute significantly to global warming and climate change. Apart from this, the excessive usage of nitrogen-based fertilizers can cause water pollution, and it can even affect the quality of the soil. So such a reduction in the quality of soil, which is induced through the overusage of fertilizers, is referred to as soil sickness. Now let's take up the next article. An expert panel of the Ministry of Information and Broadcasting has cleared hundreds of applications which will allow the establishment of many more community radio stations. These community radio stations are basically low-powered FM stations which have a small operating range. They generally have a range of around 15 kilometers, and they play a very important role in delivering community services and providing communication facilities in remote areas. Especially in regions which are vulnerable to natural disasters, community radio stations can play a very important role in organizing rescue and relief measures in the aftermath of the natural disaster. So the promotion of community radio stations has become an integral part of disaster management. Such community radio stations have already played a very important role in the disaster management efforts, especially in the coastal areas which are highly vulnerable to natural disasters. For example, in the state of Kerala, during the floods of 2018 and during Cyclone Fani in Odisha, these community radio stations played a very important role in retaining communication facilities in the remote areas and in providing for rescue and relief measures as a part of the disaster management efforts. So in India, Tamil Nadu has the highest number of community radio stations, closely followed by Uttar Pradesh, Maharashtra and Karnataka. Now let's take up the next article. The Indian Navy has commissioned the LCU L56, which is an amphibious ship. This is the sixth ship to be inducted under the Landing Craft Utility category, and it belongs to the MK4 class of ships. It has been built by the GRSE, or the Garden Reach Shipbuilders and Engineers, which is located in Kolkata. And the Navy has congratulated the GRSE for becoming the first shipyard in India which has built 100 warships. This amphibious ship can be used for transportation and deployment of battle tanks, armored vehicles and soldiers. And it can also be used for search and rescue operations as a part of humanitarian assistance and disaster relief. This amphibious ship is capable of multi-role activities and it can also be used for maritime surveillance and coastal patrol. So the LCU L56 will be based out of the Tri-Services Command that is located at the Andaman and Nicobar Islands. Now let's take up an editorial which deals with the Afghan conflict. The editorial has been written in the context of the upcoming elections in Afghanistan and the recent terror attack against the vice presidential candidate Mr. Amrullah Saleh. Amrullah Saleh has always been a good friend of India and he was also the former intelligence chief of Afghanistan. So in his capacity as an intelligence chief, he was completely opposed to the Taliban and he was critical of Pakistan for extending covert support to the Taliban outfits. So the president of Afghanistan, Ashraf Ghani, has chosen Amrullah Saleh as his running mate for the post of the vice president in the upcoming elections in Afghanistan. So the recent attack carried out by the Taliban, which was targeted against Amrullah Saleh, is a clear indication that the Taliban is trying to show the civilian government that it will do everything in its capacity to disrupt the upcoming elections. Today, the Taliban occupies a position of strength in Afghanistan because it is able to exert control over more than 50% of Afghan territory. Large parts of southern and western Afghanistan is largely under the control of the Taliban, and this poses a direct challenge to the legitimacy of a civilian government. So this ground reality has further emboldened the Taliban and it has increased the scale and the frequency of terror attacks which is targeting innocent civilians and as well as the armed forces and the government of Afghanistan. So on one hand, the Taliban is blatantly increasing violence in Afghanistan without facing any consequences. And on the other hand, it is negotiating a peace deal with the United States through secret negotiations which have been going on at Doha in Qatar since the last few months. The United States is desperately looking to withdraw its troops from Afghanistan by striking a peace deal with the Taliban. So this has become a core objective of the Donald Trump administration, and the US president has even appointed a special envoy to engage in political negotiations with the Taliban. So through the ongoing peace negotiations, the US and Taliban are looking to work out an arrangement wherein the American forces will not target the Taliban and they will allow the Taliban to return to political power, and in return, the Taliban will not target any American interests. So these negotiations have reduced the military and international political pressure on Taliban, and it ignores the fact that the Taliban is still actively involved in promoting insurgency and violence against the civilian government of Afghanistan. So in a way, the US is indirectly allowing the Afghan civilian government to be weakened for the sake of a peace deal with Taliban, which will allow the US to withdraw its troops and make a face-saving exit from the Afghan civil war. So the editorial is critical of this approach of the United States, which is allowing the return of a radical insurgent outfit such as the Taliban. The editorial says that the Taliban continues to pose a threat not just for Afghanistan but for the entire region, and the global community led by the United States should keep this in mind and they should continue to exert diplomatic and international pressure so that the Taliban can put a stop to the violence which is mainly targeted at the civilian government. The editorial is asking the US and the international community to take further steps to strengthen the Afghan civilian government and its armed forces and support the people of Afghanistan to successfully conduct the upcoming elections so that the influence of the Taliban can be curtailed. And the US should not only be motivated by its self-interest, but it should look at the larger interests of the region, and it should exert political and military pressure on Taliban and ensure that radicalism and extremism doesn't return to Afghanistan. Now let's take up the next article. The National Commission of Minorities has said that only the central government has the powers to declare a community as a minority community. This decision of the National Commission has come based on a petition which was requesting the National Commission of Minorities to declare the Hindus as a minority community in those states where they do not form majority of the population. For example, in states such as Nagaland and Jammu and Kashmir, the Hindus are not in majority, and this petitioner was requesting the National Commission of Minorities to declare the Hindus in these states as a minority community. So in order to look into this issue, the National Commission for Minorities had set up a subcommittee, and based on a thorough review, the National Commission has said that it does not have the powers to declare a community as a minority community because these powers are vested only with the central government. It's only the center which can declare a community as a minority community. Because the responsibility of the National Commission for Minorities is only to ensure the progress and development of minorities and protect their religious, cultural, and educational rights. These two responsibilities have been placed on the National Commission for Minorities through various legislations that have been passed by the Parliament and as well as by some of the provisions which are enshrined in the Indian Constitution. According to these provisions, the National Commission for Minorities only has the powers to protect the religious, cultural, and educational rights of minorities and to work towards their progress and development. It clearly does not have the powers to declare a community as a minority community. These powers clearly lie with the central government, and the National Commission has even referred to the Supreme Court judgment in the Bal Patil case in order to justify its stand. Because in the Bal Patil judgment of 1999, the Supreme Court had laid out the functions for the National Commission of Minorities. The Supreme Court had referred to the Indian Constitution and as well as the National Commission for Minorities Act of 1992. And by using this as a reference, it had laid out the responsibilities of the National Commission for Minorities. So if you look at the functions that have been assigned to the National Commission, it becomes very clear that it does not have the powers to declare a community as a minority community. Now let's take up the practice questions. Geographical Indication Tag or GI Tag is covered under which of the following international agreement? The correct answer is option C. GI tags are covered under the TRIPS agreement of the World Trade Organization. Now let's take up the second question. Which of the following greenhouse gases has the highest global warming potential? The correct answer is option D, sulfur hexafluoride. Now please take up an exercise over here. I want you to read about global warming potential and list the different greenhouse gases according to their respective global warming potential. Now let's move on to the third question. Which of the following statements are correct with regard to CITES? It completely prohibits international trade in endangered species of wild fauna and flora. This is a wrong statement because the CITES convention doesn't impose a blanket prohibition on international trade in endangered species. Instead, it only regulates international trade in endangered species. It maintains three appendices or three lists known as Appendix 1, 2, and 3. and only those endangered species which are listed under Appendix 1, they are prohibited from being traded internationally. But in the other two categories, the CITES convention only imposes a regulation. So it would be wrong to say that CITES convention completely prohibits international trade. So statement 1 is wrong. It is also known as the Washington Convention. This is a correct statement. The CITES convention is also referred to as the Washington Convention. So option B is the correct answer. Now let's take up a map-based question. A terror group known as Boko Haram, which is recently in news, operates in which country? The correct answer is option D, Nigeria. Now let's take up a question from the 2017 prelims paper. Due to some reasons, if there is a huge fall in the population of species of butterflies, what could be its likely consequence? Pollination of some plants could be adversely affected. This is definitely true because butterflies play an important role in the propagation of pollen grains. There could be a drastic increase in the fungal infections of some cultivated plants. This is a wrong statement because butterflies have nothing to do with the spread of fungal infections in plants. The third statement says it could lead to a fall in the population of some species of wasps, spiders, and birds. This is a correct statement because whenever there is a sudden decrease in the population of a particular species, it will definitely have an impact on the entire food chain which is dependent on it. So naturally, if the species of butterflies go down all of a sudden, it will definitely have an impact on wasps, spiders, and birds. So option C is the correct answer. Statements 1 and 3 are correct, whereas the second statement is wrong. Now let's take up a mains practice question. India has registered a phenomenal success in its tiger conservation program. In the light of this statement, elaborate on India's efforts in implementing Project Tiger. Please write an answer to this question and post your answers in the comment section below. So this concludes our discussion for the day. Thanks for watching.